Distinguished guests, may I have your attention, please? The next keynote of Mobile World Congress Los Angeles 2021 will commence in 5 minutes. We kindly ask that you please take your seats. Distinguished guests, your attention.
While society was on hold, we've responded to a global crisis. And throughout the pandemic, we've worked tirelessly to monitor, inform, and protect. Now we're getting back to business and building remarkable connections. Back to sealing that deal while innovating for the future. Getting back together, however it suits you. This is where billions of lives can be improved every day. Where 5G is advancing technology. and where we're unlocking the power of connectivity so that people, industry, and society thrive. This year, we're exploring the hottest technology that will create global impact, redefine business, and reimagine society. Look forward to a better future, pushing for breakthroughs and delivering on our collective goals. Let's look forward to sun, sand, and sealing that deal. Thank you to our iconic host city and to everyone who makes MWC the success it is. Let's get back to business, back to LA, back together.
MWCLA. We are back.
Oh, right. Just got reminded that I got to take my mask off, which is crazy to think about. But thank you, everybody, for joining. Thank you, GSMA, for having us, and CTI for presenting this. My name is Jefferson Wang. I'm from Accenture. I'm the global 5G lead and the network lead. So excited to have this panel here. You know, I don't think there's been a time where we've seen this big of two giant tectonic trends kind of come together. When you think about the power and the innovation of cloud coming together with what's happening from a network perspective, and you look at 5G, these two tectonic trends are creating some incredible innovation opportunities. And I think that's why we're so excited to share this opportunity with you today. We're going to be talking about what are some of the new network technologies, from network slicing to the use cases of millimeter wave, both on the consumer side and the business side. How now, as we decouple and as we disaggregate parts of the network, what does that mean from a security perspective? And then ultimately, how can this 5G and cloud opportunities come together? So it really, really strong panel. You know, I've been doing this for a long time, and this is one of the most diverse, exciting panels that I think we've been a part of. So really excited to walk you through that. You know, when we look at kind of the run of the show today, what we hope everybody gets out of it is, you know, part one, we'll hear about how zero trust and security is incredibly important with these two new trends that are happening. Next, we'll have a fireside chat with the chief marketing officer of Qualcomm around where is millimeter wave going? What can we expect from consumers? How do we think about it from an enterprise perspective? And then how do we think about, you know, a powerhouse platform like AWS? And what can we do and build together on top of that? And what are the opportunities around that? And then finishing out with a panel around where are the opportunities on 5G and what's the next generation look like? What does post-smartphone look like and where do we go? So super excited that you guys are here. Hopefully you'll get a lot out of this session. First off, would love to welcome Lee Klarich from Palo Alto Networks. He's the Executive Vice President and Chief Product Officer. So big hand for Lee, please.
Thank you. All right, good afternoon. How are you doing? Doesn't this feel cool? Is that like been like the start of every meeting you've had today, like just talking about like actually seeing people? Anyway, sorry to be like, it's like slightly nostalgic about business travel and meeting people in person, but turns out if you want to take your mask off, you should sign up to be a speaker. I recommend it. It's kind of nice and somewhat freeing. As described, my name is Lee Klarich. I'm the Chief Product Officer for Palo Alto Networks, and just really excited to be here and share some of our perspectives on 5G and just the amazing transformative nature that and force that we believe it's going to have and is already starting to have. But Specifically, and maybe not a surprise, knowing that I'm from Palo Alto Networks, we believe that that only gets unlocked if we couple that with a transformative approach to security as well. Now, to set some context, and I'm sure everyone in this audience probably has your own set of numbers to describe the trend of 5G and what it's going to mean from an industry perspective. I latched on to this really big number of $1.5 trillion market size in 2030, and I thought, oh my gosh, that's amazing. Even if it's only a third of that, it's still a relatively amazing number. But what's particularly striking to me is when you start to look at the background behind that market number, when you start to look at some of the quotes, you'll start to notice a trend around this, which is it actually is very enterprise-focused in terms of the market-enabling power that 5G is going to bring. Now, that doesn't mean that cell phones and things like that and consumers aren't going to be latched onto 5G. It's just where the new opportunity is, where the expansion opportunity is very different than the past. Now, why is that? If you think about some of the different industries that are really excited about the possibility of 5G, it's the big industrials, right? It's manufacturing, it's agriculture, it's the infrastructure companies, critical infrastructure, utilities, power plants, it's healthcare, it's the smart cities. This is actually a pretty fascinating set of verticals when you think about it. These kinds of organizations are actually some of the most security conscious organizations in the world. Yet they're latching on to the promise of 5G to enable and power their digital transformation efforts. They see the power of 5G, but they're going to bring with that a set of requirements that are very, very, very different than what has been seen in cellular technologies in the past. They are going to be driving these standards. And these are things that we've been paying attention to for the last several years, actually, preparing for this opportunity and thinking about what security technologies would be needed to enable these kinds of organizations to really leverage the power of 5G. And so when we think about this, this is not going to happen with legacy technologies. If Colonial Pipeline, as an example, runs their infrastructure through 5G, is it going to be acceptable for the hack that happened earlier this year to happen? No. No, it shouldn't be acceptable that happened earlier this year. So it's not that we have to live up to the same standard as they had before. There's a new standard. There's expectations when we go through transformation that we can achieve a new standard of security. And it will not be achieved with the legacy approaches. We have to fundamentally take a different approach. What does that approach look like? Now, I won't go through all of the gory details of this, but let me share some insights in how we think about this. First, the notion of all layers. You cannot secure what you don't see. This means you have to be able to inspect every layer of traffic, all the way up to signaling layer, management, slices, applications, content. All aspects of the traffic have to be visible to the security stack. Second, it has to be across all locations. There is this notion in security called an attack lifecycle. The concept of an attack lifecycle is an attacker has to execute multiple attacks successfully in order to carry out a successful breach. It's almost never a single thing. So the notion of all locations in the attack lifecycle is we have to take advantage of every opportunity to detect and prevent an attack that we can. You can't rely on any one single approach. Third, we have to then apply all of the learnings of security across all those locations and all those layers. We have to think about malware. We have to think about exploits. We have to think about vulnerabilities. We have to think about malicious content and malicious websites and everything else that goes with it. These are all of the different techniques that attackers use. Fourth, the architecture is fundamentally different. You all know this. Gone are the days of deploying hardware devices into data centers and then everyone backing away and saying, let's not touch it for the next 8 years. New are the days of it's software-based, it's container-based, it's microservices. It's constantly changing. It's automated, it's dynamic. That change in technology means that all of the fundamental aspects of security from before do not work in 5G. We have to rethink this from a container landscape perspective. We have to think about this in terms of how the cloud is going to play a role. We have to think about this in terms of how automation is going to play a role. We have to think about this in the context of, if I want to provision a new customer, can I do that automatically? And can I do that in a matter of seconds? And when I say in this context a customer, I mean a new utility company. Can I do that in a matter of seconds? And that will drive a whole different set of underlying technology standards. And so, and then of course, the end-to-end aspect of this is going to require multiple technology stacks from multiple customers, companies working together in a concerted fashion, leveraging AI, ML, automation to make sure that everything is intertwined from a provisioning perspective. We have built everything that you see here into our approach. We're not the only ones, which is good. We're working with many of the big industry players on the network side, on the automation side, and the management side in order to make this happen. But regardless of us, these are the principles that need to be applied in order to enable the kind of transformation that 5G can bring. Now, one last thought for me. Every time, at least that I've engaged in the conversation around securing mobile infrastructure and networks in the past, it was always a discussion about the left-hand side. Security is a cost center. I don't make money from it, so I want to limit how much money I need to spend on security for my mobile infrastructure. I want to do enough, but I don't want to do too much. One of the really interesting transformations that happens with 5G is that security has the power to become a profit center. Imagine building out virtual 5G networks for large enterprises, critical infrastructure, healthcare providers, smart cities, manufacturers. These are organizations that value security. These are organizations that actually would view that as a value add, something worth paying for. And so not only does getting security right have the benefit of actually securing this new infrastructure in a better way, a more automated way, in a more complete way, but it has the power to transform the business of doing this into one of a profit center, one that can be a value add on top of all of the other services that are being provided. That is my perspective. That is the perspective of Palo Alto Networks. And this is what we have been building toward enabling, because we believe fundamentally this is a core aspect to how 5G is going to achieve that transformative power in the industry. And so with that, I would like to say thank you very much. Hand it back over.
I I think you can see how exciting of a position that we're in, right? That as you look at security becoming something that has to be embedded into the fabric of how we build and operate these, that almost becomes sacrosanct to unlock the next fireside chat that we're gonna go into. So if you really think about how important, if you talk about a consumer use case or an enterprise use case, anything mission critical or anything that the consumers touch, trust has to be in the middle of that. So may I have everybody give a big round of applause to Don McGuire, the Chief Marketing Officer of Qualcomm.
Good to have you. Tune in? All right.
All right.
I do have a cool Halloween mask, though, so I'm kind of bummed I can't wear it up here. But
Don should come back and put it on, because it's fantastic. Don took the train up from San Diego yesterday, and, you know, I was just thinking about your commute. You know, how different would that be in Europe as we're starting to deploy 5G in railways? How different would we be? But you guys have been a pioneer in millimeter wave. There's a lot of talk around, can it supply the needs? What are some, like, consumer use cases you're specifically excited about in millimeter wave?
Yeah, I think, I mean, thanks to our colleague from Palo Alto Networks, because a lot of the use cases he talked about from a security perspective, really don't come to life without it. And it's not about if, it's really about when or how, because 5G, or the deployment of 5G is really a layer cake exercise, right? It's not just about low band, it's not just about mid band. And I know that the way the spectrum auctions have gone, you know, sometimes spectrum was licensed earlier in the low bands and later in the high bands, but it's really about kind of all of the above to really unlock the full potential of 5G. And this will be the first generation of wireless that really the potential is realized outside the phone. He mentioned all those industrial use cases and enterprise use cases going on. And so if we're going to realize that potential, it's really going to take all flavors of 5G, including millimeter wave at the high bands. Speaking on the consumer side for a second, what I'm excited about is a couple things. First and foremost, there's a pain point with regards to live entertainment that has existed in the 4G world that I think the deployment of millimeter wave and advanced networks from a venue perspective is going to solve. And everybody can probably relate to this, where you go to a concert of your favorite artist, or you go to the Super Bowl, or you go to a football game, and you're having a great experience. And you want to share that experience with your friends and family who aren't lucky enough to be there, and you want to gloat, and you want to brag, and you can't. Because you cannot text, you cannot call, you cannot upload, you cannot download. You can't do anything because the network is clogged. And no matter how many portable cell sites that the operators put around the stadium, you know, firing LTE into the stadium, it just locks up. So one of the great use cases of 5G millimeter wave, and we're seeing it being deployed in a lot of use cases from a stadium and venue perspective today, is unlocking the shareable experience for people. Because it is a huge pain point today for consumers. And if you look at, you know, generations of consumers, one of the most important things from millennials on down to Gen Z, they want to do is share their experiences. And the device they use to share their experiences with primarily today is the smartphone. So unlocking that shareableness of experiences is a really killer use case. It is a point in time use case, but it is a use case. And Verizon did a phenomenal job at the Super Bowl this year in Tampa, right, creating the most connected stadium in the world with a lot of help from partners like Qualcomm and others. So that's an example of that. We are actually the official core technology partner, 5G core technology partner of Live Nation. So we've been working with Live Nation on deployment of millimeter wave-based networks at venues for concerts and reimagining the live music experience for those fans. So we're excited about that. And again, it's a point-in-time experience. And you might say, well, that's just, you know, that's a lot of, like, effort for, like, one stadium in one city. But it really is not really about a point in time. It's about a day in the life. Because, as you mentioned Europe, and you mentioned rail stations and 5G being deployed in rail stations, if you go through the day of the life of somebody who's a commuter when life goes back to full normality, or even if they're just stuck in their home still, how millimeter wave can help enhance the experience throughout a normal average day of a consumer is the sky's kind of the limit. Whether you're going to the train station to commute and you're in the train station, you're trying to be productive, you're trying to do on-demand computing, right? You're trying to connect via video conferencing, 5G millimeter wave private network in that train station is going to make that experience better, faster, you know, more efficient for you. and for the operator deploying that network to provide you that service. And you go from the train station to your campus at work, and your campus, your enterprise has decided to deploy a 5G private network to balance traffic, to increase the amount of capacity they have for things like video conferencing, on-demand compute, or virtual presence, or spatial computing, which again, most Wi-Fi networks today cannot handle that kind of traffic. And then you leave work and you go to the pub or you go high street retail or something like that, and you've got, you know, 5G capabilities as you're shopping, things like that. So it really does apply to a day in the life. So I think that that's another kind of misnomer about millimeter wave is, oh, it's only good for stadiums, right? That's not true. And then the third thing is really about bridging the digital divide, because fixed wireless access, which really benefits from millimeter wave, can actually help bridge the digital divide in rural America, right? We've done tests with US Cellular and other partners. You can get a gigabit speeds up to 6 miles in a fixed wireless configuration, which is pretty phenomenal. So bridging digital divide, bringing higher speeds, and more capacity for education, for in-home use, right, for small business in some of these smaller towns in rural America. Again, another exciting use case for millimeter wave. So that's what I'm excited about. And then, of course, gaming. So, but I won't talk about gaming right now. But in order to really have massive multiplayer gaming in a streaming environment, you're going to need millimeter wave. You can't do that over sub-6. So those are the things on a consumer level that I'm most excited about.
I think it's so interesting. Even the first example you gave at a stadium, we did some work on a stadium, and depending upon the type of concert, you see a whole different usage pattern. And no offense, but there's, you know, a Lady Gaga concert, and it's 10 times the amount of traffic that they're trying to get out, and they can't do it, versus like maybe a Rolling Stones concert, where you don't get the quite same usage. And you see that in that entire day in the life you just described.
Yeah, but sharing behavior is a little different at the Gaga concert versus the Rolling Stones concert, I imagine.
Yeah, true story, too. By
yeah, yeah, I mean, the CTO of Live Nation, when we first sat down with them and we started talking about deployment strategies, true story, Foo Fighters concert, of course, the lead singer says, everybody, you hold up your phone and do this.
Don't do that, is whatever the network's
plan
is.
The point of sale systems, the back office, the production, everything crashed in that venue at that moment in time. So again, it's just another reality of the situation. So excited about what millimeter wave can do to correct that.
Yeah, and the balance that you talked about, that there'll be a macro layer that mid or sub six low can handle,
yep.
But then where are the right points in time, the moments that matter,
sure.
Where millimeter wave takes in. When you look at that and we migrate the conversation to enterprise, mm-hmm. How do you see kind of millimeter wave playing the role in the enterprise? What are the use cases that excite you in there?
Similar use cases to what we saw earlier as far as industrial and enterprise use cases. A lot of the opening video stuff that you saw, none of that happens without millimeter wave. I mean, I'm just being real right now. It just doesn't happen, right? Because of the ultra low latency and the ultra reliability that happens within a 5G private network, for example, in Factory 4.0, if you want to switch lines or if you want robotics that actually is in real time or decision making that's in real time by artificial intelligence, you need that low latency, but you need that reliability. And those metrics are only delivered, right, in a millimeter wave environment. But that's the sort of the factory configuration sort of example. But healthcare, making critical on-site decisions, especially in urban environments, if you're doing mobile hospital types of configurations where you're having to transmit data real-time between EMTs and doctors back at the hospital, there's too much traffic, they can't get the patient back, you need to transfer data, whether it's x-rays or ultrasounds or whatever it might be. Again, time matters, seconds matter. Right, in those situations. So that's where these things really shine, and it's obvious to people then. But across enterprise use cases, I mentioned on-demand computing and spatial computing. As we go back to work in whatever that new normal is, whether it's 3 days in the office and 2 days not, or 2 days in the office and 3 days not, there's gonna be this enterprisation that has to happen outside of your building, right? Whether it's in other buildings, whether it's back to your employee's home, or to another area. So building that, the VPN capabilities and the on-demand and spatial computing capabilities of your network gets more demanding as we go back to this new normal from an enterprise perspective. And that's where I think 5G private networks and overlaying millimeter wave, as well as Wi-Fi 6, Wi-Fi 7 types of applications, and the interaction between those two are going to be really, really important to kind of enterprise more broadly across campuses and even beyond those campuses. So I think that's really interesting as well. So I think, you know, mission critical services, EMTs, life kind of threatening types of stuff. And then on the automotive side, on transportation, really V2X. Right, the in creating a safer driving environment, not only for the driver, but also for everything around the car, as it's traveling through, you know, its route or its journey, is something that 5G is going to bring to life, right? And millimeter wave is going to again offer that reliability when you have to make decisions, whether they're AI based or braking based, or do you hit the pedestrian or do you not, right? That's like a nanosecond, and you can't wait for the data to go up to the cloud and have the data come back, because then the person's dead. So you have to have
maybe just running a red light.
Maybe you're just running a red light, but so you have to have that again low latency, reliability, and capacity to be able to make those mission critical decisions. So V2X really doesn't, again, come to life in its full potential without millimeter wave.
Yeah, if you dig into kind of some of the ones you mentioned, that even in healthcare, how many megabits or terabytes of data transfer back and forth on like a PET scan or a CAT scan?
Exactly.
There's cost in that. Mm-hmm. There's time associated to that. Yeah. All that, what can we make better from that perspective? In the autonomous world, like you mentioned, when can we figure out if there's a decision point on onboard compute versus the network, and as we move it to the network, when is it ready? What are the use cases we can unlock? How do we make it better or live in that hybrid world? And the work examples, I think, perfect for everybody, right? In this post-COVID world we're coming out of, this event is hybrid. So there's people watching this on stream who are watching Don, right, and figuring out how to collaborate. That's a totally new normal, right? Yeah. And you guys do so much on XR2, all the other areas as we try and push into capture, to get into metaverse, to get into interaction, to get into collaboration.
Right.
There's so much on the enterprise side alone.
Yeah, I mean, the opportunities are really limitless. I mean, it's pretty amazing. And what our world's going to look like in 12 months, 24 months, 48 months is just going to be completely different. I mean, if you look at the data curves, right, I think we've all seen them, you know, Accenture publishes them, on the demand for data and the data that's going to be transferred through the networks by 2024, 2025, it is astronomical. And you run out of mid-band and low-band spectrum. So you have to deploy, if your phone is going to work in 2025, you're going to have to deploy a full layer cake strategy with your network strategy in order for you to just basically offer basic operation and service to your customers. That's the demand that's coming upon us and the world's going to see. So it's exciting on the one hand, but like, no one should kid themselves, right? It's not an if, it's really a when. And if that is going to be the case in 2025, you have to start thinking about deployment now.
Yeah, it's so true that we always think about, we're just going to snap our fingers and all of a sudden this is going to stand up, and all of a sudden that the modems are going to show up into the OEMs, and all of a sudden those devices are going to be safe for network. But there's a whole orchestration that needs to go on.
Absolutely.
To time this, right?
Yeah.
You know, and then when you look at the challenges to 5G, you and I talked a little bit about this. If we look at just millimeter wave, we thought about pandemic, supply chain, chipset, slowdown. Where do you see us today in terms of millimeter wave rollouts? And let's think globally, right? This
sure.
is a US conference, but globally, yeah. Where does Qualcomm see that for millimeter wave?
Well, I think the US, obviously, we're in really good shape. All three operators have millimeter wave as part of their plans. Verizon obviously taking the lead in deploying it first. I think they're going to be at 30,000 sites by the end of this year. They just mentioned on their earnings call. That's fantastic. Great progress there. And AT&T and T-Mobile as well. And then Dish is kind of, you know, figuring out their network strategy. So I think the U.S. we're good. We've seen deployments, commercial deployments in Australia, in Europe, in Korea, in Southeast Asia, and Japan. And we're excited about what we're doing with China Unicom for the Beijing Olympics. We're going to be bringing millimeter wave to life, and we're going to be showcasing use cases at the Olympics themselves in China. So that's a huge step, I think. You know, and then once China's on board, you know, it kind of opens up right a huge global sort of waterfall.
So, it's its own ecosystem.
Yeah, it's its own ecosystem. So I think that the momentum is all there. Beyond all those commercial deployments, pretty much every operator around the world is doing some sort of trial, some sort of testing with millimeter wave. I think it's over 100 operators beyond the ones that have deployed so far. So momentum is there. It's catching fire. It's just a matter of, you know, figuring out the economics, the use cases, the data traffic, finding those inflection points. And then and one of the things holding it back in some countries is just spectrum auctions, right? In Latin America, those are coming up, for example, and then they'll be able to deploy. So once that's all kind of cleared, I think everybody's going to be in a really good position to actually deploy that kind of layer cake strategy.
Do you see each geography learning from each other and kind of sharing that knowledge on deployments and the challenges? I mean, you mentioned U.S. Cellular going 6 miles on millimeter wave line of sight. That's a feat in itself. I remember when we were first doing this, we had SDA spectrum. We did 100 meters.
Right.
Untuned, completely just,
sure,
you know,
sure.
just prototype stuff. But right. 6 miles, that's
six
out
miles.
Of control.
Out of control. Gigabit speeds at 6 miles? I mean, I can't even get like 200 megabits per second to my house right now.
Yeah. That's right.
I have 60-year-old copper.
You're on copper
to
on
my
your last mile. Or
yeah.
Something.
So it's pretty amazing. And I think that there are learnings that are being deployed. I know Verizon has shared a lot of their learnings with other operators. They've flown to other countries and given speeches on the network deployment strategy and what they're seeing as far as use cases, data traffic, speeds, you know, reliability, capacity, and how they've architected the network. So I know, and what they're doing with fixed wireless access too is pretty incredible, the momentum they have around FWA here in the US. And I think that they are sharing those stories.
That's fantastic. Yeah. You know, so we've taken a journey, a day in the life of the consumer, what's possible, what is actually happening. We've looked at the enterprise side of things, where mission-critical networks require this latency, this security, this reliability, this capacity. We've looked at, when you think about where we're going from a global perspective, it's happening. You mm-hmm. said LATAM coming online. I think this, you know, this year's spectrum auction will happen.
Yep.
Eventually, we'll start to deploy next 2 years. What's the future look like? Where does millimeter wave go from here?
Well, I mean, like all parts of 5G, right? 5G has a long runway. We're only in the sort of the first quarter of the game. We've got Release 16, features being commercially developed and deployed. We're going to go into Release 17, Release 18, get to 5G advanced, just like we got to LTE advanced, right? Over the course, everything hasn't advanced. But some things that are going to be exciting, I think, especially for operators in Release 16, Release 17, are three things that I can think of. One is better beam management. You know, millimeter wave is a beamform, it uses beamforming technology for that, you know, for the service off, you know, to provide efficient and effective service to the user. And there's gonna be better beam management rolled out in Release 16 and Release 17 that's gonna enable operators to actually be more efficient and more reliable and drive better performance with their beamforming technology in millimeter wave, so that's one thing. Another thing is unlicensed spectrum. And higher band millimeter spectrum, that's going to be available.
Yeah, 60 gigahertz.
60 gigahertz. Unlicensed spectrum is going to be great for some of these use cases like private networks, yeah. right? So I think that's something to look forward to. And then the third thing is this integrated access and backhaul, which basically is going to be able to enable wireless backhaul between base stations, right? And so that's going to allow for, you know, sort of better management overall, machine learning-based network management. It's going to free up a lot of densification strategies, provide more flexibility to operators for those densification strategies. So in this integrated access and backhaul that's going to come with Release 16, I think, is another thing to look forward to. So there's a lot of things happening in Release 16, Release 17. Again, you know, from a technology perspective for the operators and for everybody else, but also, you know, very few of these Release 16, Release 17 features are about the phone, right? They're much more about the scalability and the promise of 5G to change societies, to change municipalities, to change business, to change industry. And so that's pretty exciting.
Now, you mentioned something that's a hot topic right now, private cellular networks. Have you seen more and more pull on private cellular networks, and how do you see that working with the macro network?
Yeah, I think that there's a couple configurations we're seeing in momentum for a couple different places. So in Germany, they're actually allowing private enterprise to buy spectrum for themselves, for their own use. So you've got big players like Siemens and Bosch who are really worried about protecting their data. I mean, we had a security we had Palo Alto up here earlier talking about security, very, very concerned about that. So they're really into the deployment of private networks, and they're actually able to get spectrum themselves and not have to go through the operator to actually deploy these networks. So that's more of a direct sort of relationship type of of configuration for our private networks that we're seeing momentum around. And the other is the operators themselves offering private networks as a service, right? Going in and helping enterprises set up these networks and getting the most out of the different layers of 5G as well as with Wi-Fi, integrating the two, figuring out the use cases, and helping deploy the right network strategy, right? Whether it's a mesh strategy plus a 5G wideband strategy, et cetera, so that the enterprise can deliver on whatever the needs are, right, for their business and for their employees. So we're seeing a lot of movement around that, where the operators are actually out there sort of packaging these types of services up and working with enterprise on how to deploy them. And I think over the next 24 to, again, 36 months, we're going to see examples of them popping up, you know, in different configurations and different circumstances, used as showcases, again, to advance the private network sort of agenda.
Yeah. I hope you guys kind of see the passion that, and what I notice most when Don talks about this is there's a clarity to it. And right now we're at a moment at an industry where we need clarity, because there is some confusion around, are we going to make it back from the spectrum auctions? My goodness, how far out did the business case push? What is my role as an operator in the value chain? Do I belong on a first party service? Am I supposed to go to the platform level? What do those economics look like? So I think now more than ever, the clarity to be able to actually have the confidence to move forward and have the industry work together to support this. So it's super exciting and really appreciate
it. Yeah, no problem. And Boingo just announced they're doing a private network with the San Diego Padres at Petco Park. So, and again, another example of private networks being deployed and manifesting themselves. And everybody's interested. I know the operators in the room and all the technology companies in the room probably would agree with me. They say, enterprise is coming to us, asking to help solve their problems. Right, and so whatever the flavor looks like, or whatever the combination of solutions is or are, it's not like we're having to go overly market to them, right? They're coming to us. Cities, municipalities, governments, regulators, schools, education systems are all coming to us for solutions. The last 18 to 20 months has driven a lot of that, as the technology curve has, adoption curve has accelerated. But it's not a shortage of ask or want or need. It's just about, you know, how fast can we service, right? So it's a pretty exciting time.
Big round of applause. Don McGuire, Chief Marketing Officer of Qualcomm,
thank you.
Everybody.
Thanks a lot, man.
So
appreciate
much.
It.
Well done.
Okay.
All right. If we could keep that rolling, Chief Technologist, Telecom Edge and Cloud of AWS, Ishwar Parulkar, please welcome to the stage.
Thanks for the introduction. I'm going to shift gears from spectrum and airwaves to bits and bytes and infrastructure. When I moved, I spent a lot of years in the telecom world and moved to AWS 5 years ago because I was convinced that what the cloud was able to do with enterprises, applications, and verticals, the way it was able to transform this, had the potential to transform telecom as well. If you look at the network, it's infrastructure. It's infrastructure at scale. It's infrastructure with multiple tenants. That's what the cloud is. If you look at a high-level digital system, you can think of it as compute, storage, and networking. With the cloud, we've been able to achieve a lot of this on the compute storage side, and I think the time is right to look at it, look at what it can do for networks. So, do you have the clicker? Let's take a look at where 5G deployments are today. 5G had a bold vision of enhanced broadband, massive connectivity of devices, and ultra low latency, single millisecond latency. And we are on our journey. Don said we're in the first quarter. I believe it's just the kickoff. If you look at where we are today, we have virtualization and disaggregation of the packet core. Network function vendors are building the packet core in a cloud-native way. Networks are transitioning. They're building 5G as a transition from LTE to 5G. So there's non-standalone architectures that are in play, and you don't realize the full potential of 5G when you're in that state. So we're still not there in terms of full 5G. OpenStack has been tried by operators And what they're seeing is challenges with manageability, configuration, and operations, because you're relying on a lot of open source plugins, open source software. It's coming from different places and different pieces. And so that's kind of a realization that the industry has come to, that it's not so easy to just virtualize a network and run it like an application. Lastly, the RAN piece. You know, it's still integrated hardware appliances, right? It's still single stack from a single vendor. So there's a lot to do in that space as well to really realize the full potential of 5G. So the full potential of 5G is not just massive bandwidth and latency and massive connectivity, but it's really getting the benefit of lower cost savings by using assets that are already there. I mean, if you look at the cloud, if you look at the hyperscalers, there's edge data centers, there's fiber in the ground, there's backbone networks, and that can be leveraged to lower the cost of ownership. Secondly, it's about reducing staff productivity, using automation, using CI/CD methods of deploying applications. You can reduce the effort required for operations. It's also about operational resilience. The cloud was built to be secure and resilient from grounds up. It is a multi-tenant environment, so the foundation of the cloud has been, how do you allow multiple tenants to share infrastructure and vital workloads in a secure manner? So that's the other piece that needs to be brought to 5G. And lastly, about business agility. If you look at how much time it takes in traditional networks to deploy a new service and to operate that, it's orders of magnitude away from what we can do in the cloud today. So that's kind of the last piece here, which is really bringing agility to building, developing new services, and deploying them and having consumers use them. So, but beyond that, it's about uncovering new value. And connectivity has been the bread and butter of telcos for a long time, but there's new value to be uncovered when you start building networks in this different way. So one is just building new types of services. So traditional connectivity services, taking them to a new level by reinventing how you offer them, how you build them. Building private networks, building software-defined WAN fabrics, building applications that include connectivity bundled with computing at the edge, like connected cars. Don referred to some use cases there. These are the new services that you can build, and they're not only in the connectivity space, but just a new class of services: smart home, cloud DVR, media transformation services that happen at the edge. So there's a whole set of new services that could be built. Secondly, the pricing model can be changed dramatically. If you have a dynamic programmable network, you can have consumption based on usage as opposed to fixed slabs that the telcos are used to offering. And lastly, today you have a few bundles that are served to all of the customers, consumers, as well as enterprises and businesses. And those can be highly personalized. If you look at the data that's available in terms of devices, in terms of subscribers, applications that run on the network, you can mine the data using modern AI ML techniques to really offer targeted bundles towards customers. And again, this is something we do in the cloud. Naturally, it's something that we've built over the last few years, and network being an infrastructure can take advantage of some of these things if you use cloud as a foundation to build the networks. And that's the journey we've been on the last few years. So there's two key enablers to making that happen, though. So just going beyond connectivity and really building the network in a very different, agile, dynamically programmable, elastic manner. And one key is network slicing. And I just want to bring out a few elements to kind of show you the parallels between how we do things in the cloud and how those could be applied to the network. So as you all know, slices are just virtual partitions of a network sharing same physical resources. So you have a slice for mobile devices, you have a slice for video cameras or for connected vehicles and so forth. The first key thing you need to do, or you need to be able to do, is share resources across these slices. So essentially you have CPUs carved out, assigned with guaranteed capacity for each of these slices. So that's one key element that's required. Secondly, it has to be dynamic. You need to be able to create a slice when you need it, and targeted in terms of capacity, in terms of latency, in terms of some security posture towards that use case. So it's a dynamic creation of the slice. And secondly, it's scaling. Based on capacity requirements, if you need more capacity, you know, peak time, peak commute time for connected vehicles, or if you have more subscribers joining the network, you need to be able to expand that capacity elastically. Lastly, it's about isolation and security as well. So if you have a slice, dedicated resources to a slice, you don't want those resources taken away or affecting the resources that have been assigned to another slice. So isolation of resources across these slices is very key. And secondly, you want them isolated in terms of security and faults as well. If you have a fault, if you have a network down event in one part of the network, you don't want that affecting a bunch of users who are on different slices. The same thing with security threats, a security attack from one slice, you don't want that trickling into other slices. Now, if you look at it, this is what we do in the cloud. So there's also the wireless resources utilization, virtualization piece. So if you look at wireless, it has its own challenges in terms of virtualization. The wireless interface capacity depends on environmental factors as well as loading. So it's a more challenging case in terms of virtualization because you're not sure of how much capacity you need. So you need more dynamic nature of the infrastructure to allow for slicing, especially on the wireless interfaces. So if you look at what we do in the cloud, the compute, we have compute instances, which are actually virtually carved instances out of physical servers. We have a virtualization architecture that's based on what we call the Nitro stack. Essentially, we have a dedicated chipset that offloads some of the hypervisor heavy-duty work, allowing all of the resources to be available for actual computing and applications. And what that gives you is bare metal performance with the benefits of virtualization. Secondly, we have isolation of memory and CPU in these EC2 instances, which ties directly to how you want to isolate network resources between slices. So beyond just network slicing, one of the key other enablers is the RAN piece. As I mentioned earlier, the core is pretty solid now in terms of how it's built. It's cloud native, it's built on a service-based architecture. It has modern interfaces. It uses HTTP as opposed to traditional radio interfaces. And like SCTP. And so the core is pretty solid in terms of its deployment, but the RAN is where I think we still need a lot of work to be done to make it as cloud native as the core is today. And ORAN is one of the approaches we think which can help us get there. So obviously, one of the first things that ORAN does is disaggregate and virtualize the components. Now you can plug and play different components, you can scale them differently, you can update them differently, and again, now you're getting close to the cloud model of how you want to deploy infrastructure. The second piece is interfaces, standard interfaces, so that you can have multiple vendors hosted on the same infrastructure. Lastly, it's abstraction of layers as well. So what we have in the ORAN is the service and management orchestration layer, the SMO layer, which provides a neat interface between the infrastructure, underlying infrastructure, the applications that are running on top, which are the packet core and the RAN stack virtualized, to be able to be managed with a single pane of glass using the techniques that we do in the cloud to automate deployment, to upgrade, to patch, as well as optimize across the end-to-end network. Secondly, there is this abstraction of the radio intelligent controller, or the RIC. And that's another key piece in terms of managing and orchestrating and optimizing the network. And again, being a part of the service management orchestration layer, you can apply some of the services that you have in the cloud, the AI ML services, the scaling, auto-scaling services that we use to create elastic computing environments to actually create an elastic RAN. So there's a lot of benefits to having something like ORAN, where you are decomposing the functions, creating layers of abstraction and interfaces, making it much more applicable to using cloud as the infrastructure and as the management layer on top. And the way it all comes together is what we're doing, for example, with Dish, is really building an end-to-end network using this stack. So we have the AWS regions, which are our large data centers. We have four of them in the US, some more spread across the world, where we run most of our workloads. But then we have local zones, and these are edge sites that we manage, and we bring AWS infrastructure into those edge sites. They are at metropolitan region levels. And then we have AWS outposts, which are actually, again, racks that we actually use in our data centers, but these are racks that you could install in any other on-premise site. So telecoms can use these racks to bring AWS into their edge sites right up to the cell towers. And then you have this end-to-end infrastructure on which you can run network functions at different points. You can scale up and down. You can deploy, update, upgrade dynamically. You can create new services on top with a very agile model for deploying them. The key part here is that even though these are different sites, different edge sites, and different flavors of AWS, there's a single pane of glass across these edge sites or across these infrastructure components. So it's a single pane of glass that brings consistency of operations, it brings common APIs, and that's what you need to manage a network end-to-end. On top of it, we bring a set of cloud technologies, dynamic, elastic, closed-loop automation, which we typically use to manage this large-scale infrastructure. So all that comes with the higher layers of the stack. And then, obviously, we have the ability to host multiple network vendors, which kind of decouples the whole stack in terms of becoming more flexible, being able to use different vendors, being able to scale functions independently, being able to bring the latest features in very specific components, and most importantly, doing all these things without bringing down the infrastructure. There's no notion of scheduled maintenance in our world. We are updating, upgrading everything right from the hardware to the virtualization stack to applications without bringing a customer down ever. And that's the vision that we have of bringing to the network infrastructure. So in summary, 5G is a lot more than just the use cases we're talking about and about high bandwidth and low latency. It's really about building networks in a different way, in a very agile way, in a very dynamic way, with the ability to create new services rapidly, deploy new services rapidly, and change consumption models. Services will be consumed in a very different way once you start building networks, the same way we build the cloud. So I believe that we've started on deploying 5G, but there's a long runway here, and it's yet to fulfill its potential. And the potential is in this dynamic, large-scale infrastructure like the cloud. And the principles that made the cloud and transformed a lot of the infrastructure industry is what I think is kind of the need of the hour in terms of taking 5G to the next level and having it realize its full potential. We've made a lot of progress in really going down this path with our partners, with ISV partners. The network function developers and vendors have realized the value of building network functions in this way. And we've had tremendous support from the ecosystem in terms of really transforming how they build these applications, which have traditionally been integrated and built with traditional software technology to be built in a more cloud-native way and really leverage what the cloud has been able to do in other disciplines and other areas into the network space. Thank you for your time, and back to you. Yeah, thanks.
All right, so hope everybody kind of sees that there is this collision course between the IT side of things
and traditional networks, and then what does that mean for our industry? You know, when I look at kind of the next section, it's really going to be of a technical deep dive into all the things that you saw previously around consumer to the enterprise to cloud, converging with the network. So I'll ask you, hold your applause until I finish the three introductions, then I promise, please applaud like crazy. Harpinder Mathura, the Senior Director of Technical Marketing at Xilinx. Prasad Kodipak, the Technical Solutions Director of Radisys. Taher Bibani, the Chief Revenue Officer of Movandi. Okay, now applause, please. Great. You know, what might help for everybody is really just almost a headline from each of you guys on your respective companies that might help ground us, then we can jump in, and maybe Prasad, just a headline from Radisys.
Sure. My name is Prasad Kodipak. I'm the Director of Technical Solutions at Radisys. Radisys is in the business of driving protocol stack development for Open RAN. We're also driving software-defined passive optical networking solutions, digital endpoints, and media processing engines as well.
Perfect.
Yeah, so my name is Harpinder Mathura. I'm responsible for strategic and technical marketing at Xilinx. So Xilinx is building adaptable technology enabling end-to-end 5G, which includes radio is the focus area for us. We do provide solutions for DUCU and 5G core as well as part of our wired portfolio. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Taher.
My name is Taher Bebahani. I'm the Chief Revenue and Marketing Officer for Movandi. Innovative company that develops silicon software algorithms to make 5G millimeter wave possible.
So we talked a little bit about kind of the opportunity in 5G on the consumer side and the enterprise side. If you guys each could talk about what challenges do you see, maybe just pick your top challenge, and then what's the mitigation strategy around it, and maybe Prasad, you can start.
Sure, that's a good question. So we'll take the network slicing as an example because there has been a lot of interest in that particular topic in the industry today. So since I come from a service provider's background as well. So there's a lot of good slides that showcase the concept of network slicing, but if you take a slightly deeper perspective from a standards approach, the slicing is actually complex because if you look at the mobility network as a whole, it's you have the devices ecosystem, you have the access network, then you have the core network, and you have the most important transport network that actually ties or glues all of these different components. So now you can say that, hey, if I want to actually slice a network, I can actually slice the core network, which is relatively easier. I can slice the transport network, which is also possible. Now, if we come into the radio access network, slicing of the radio access network is a little bit complicated because now when you start thinking about locking the resources for a certain amount of time, so you're actually hitting a lot of customer performance metrics, right? And then how long you can actually log those resources? Can you log them dynamically? If you can log them dynamically, can you release them once the traffic patterns have actually subsided? So the challenge is in this network slicing is that you need to be able to actually orchestrate this from an end-to-end networking perspective, and you need to be able to manage that, manage all those slices, whether it's at the core network level or the access network level, or even at the transport network level. So once the operator has that holistic perspective of the ecosystem, then you can actually build a better case for network slicing. So we see that is still a challenge. It is still in the development stages. A lot of standards were going on in release 16 and release 17. Enhancements are coming. So we still have a lot of way to go on slicing.
And it's not something we've done before, right?
Oh, yeah.
QoS is totally different than a true slice across RAN
transport. And slicing is actually a concept that was actually defined in 3GPP release 15 standards for the first time in 5G standalone architectures. So we have a long way to go.
Yeah. Harpinder, how about you?
Okay, so given that we focus on radios, I'll start with one of the challenges that we are seeing while working with tier ones and operators is in mid-band beamforming deployment. So we see that there are three key challenges there. First of all, the mid-band massive MIMO systems, they are 32 TRX or 64 TRX. So they bring a significant capacity in terms of supporting 16 spatial streams and downlink as a typical spec and 8 in uplink. But what we see in reality is that only a subset of this capacity is getting utilized. So what we see is that the scheduler has to be, in a way, rewritten for this new use case, you know, where the beam management has to be more effective. There has to be a cross-layer optimization that needs to happen with the beamforming that is happening in the radio, and also the radio resource management. I think previous speakers talked about RAN intelligent controller. You know, where all these things have to work together so that you know, you are basically coordinating the scheduling across multiple cells, not just within that. So that is number one. And number two is that with this beam-centric radios, the front haul connectivity is going is becoming quite high. So for example, a single radio is consuming 50 gig to 100 gig, even when it is compressed using modulation compression or block floating point compression. So there again, there is some innovation needs to happen where we have a lot of intelligence in radio that can conserve this bandwidth. And we know that each cell site that operator is managing, the bandwidth is a bit of an issue. And the third and most important is the power, because these radios are consuming close to 800 watts to a kilowatt, right? That is the power consumption that is happening. And majority of this power consumption is being dissipated as heat, because these PAs are running at 40% or 30% efficiency. So from that perspective, again, it is a delicate trade-off between the power that is consumed, or tens of additional power watts that you can consume in digital portion, but optimize the PA efficiency so that you can save hundreds of watts which are getting dissipated as heat within the radio. So these are the three key challenges, and we do have a line of sight to possible solutions there.
And radio is so important when you look at the total build-out cost, right? 50 to 70% is in the radio side of things, so to go through those three, incredibly important.
Right, yeah.
How about you?
So the problem we solve is exactly what we just discussed. It's coverage. So how do you take a capacity of a 5G millimeter wave G node B and bring it and expand and spread it? And how do you bring that signal from outside of a building to an inside of a building and do this cost effectively? And what we have managed to do through the technology that's actually commercialized and it's deployed today, using beamforming and very advanced algorithms and our own technology and CMOS technology, is to be able to create a network topology using existing ecosystem partners to make sure that the deployment costs are lowered and the time to deployment is also faster. I think that's critical as well, to be able to spread the signal and to make sure that businesses and consumers have access to technology very quickly.
And Mobani being able to solve it indoor and outdoor, right? Indoor specifically, something we haven't seen before, really. We've always had the challenge. People were just putting outdoor, indoor, and just dialing down the power, but that's not the right answer.
What we do is a combination of taking an infrastructure provided by our service provider partners, connecting our repeaters or smart repeaters to the, let's say, small cells as well, bringing that signal using an outdoor repeater to the four walls of a business or a structure, and then expanding that or bringing that inside as well for indoor. So both combination, and we work with a number of different partners to deliver these technologies.
That's fantastic. And when you guys think about the previous generation, we're just kind of still working through in 4G, naturally, a lot of over-the-top saw a majority of the actual benefit. Of course, network operators did very well, but you know, that's a constant challenge. In 5G now, can we tie more use cases to the network? What's gonna really drive the must-have use case to that network so that the over-the-top scenario is really controlled? And is there space for the consumer in this? And maybe Harpinder, you can.
Yeah, so I think that's a very good question, and I would say that told in previous presentation. So 5G service-based architecture is a big disruption, and it's not getting the right attention at this point. Most of the focus is on RAN side. But if you look at 5G core, it's a service-based architecture. It's cloud-native. Cloud-native functions put together constitute the core versus what we used to have in 4G, where we had mobility management entity, serving gateway and P gateway. These are physical functions, even if they were using x86. So think of it that a UE now can connect to multiple UPF functions, like user plane functions, which is the equivalent of packet data network. So you can have intermediate UPFs that could be on cell site or can be on the edge or can be on the core, and they can be dynamically allocated, and there could be multiple session management functions associated with the UE. Now, if you think from application perspective, so it's who's dictating the location of these entities? It is the application, right? Mm-hmm. So now if you roll back and think of over-the-top services, these over-the-top services which used to have free pass in 4G, they will not get the same service because they cannot really tell the operator, okay, instantiate my UPF on this side because I want low latency or I want this particular slice with this kind of SLA. So I think it's a great opportunity for operators to now monetize their network much more effectively, and there'll be a lot more collaboration with over-the-top service providers as well, because that's not going away because there are a lot of innovation happening in that space, but there'll be a tremendous opportunity where operators will share the benefit. And one of the things that we feel is that many of the operators are not focusing as much on service generation versus RAN, which may or may not be true because internally they may be doing a lot of work. But at least in external world, we don't see that similar amount of activity happening on creating new services.
That's awesome, right? Co-creation of the scaled services onto the network is a huge opportunity for everybody, right?
Right.
How about you?
So let me answer this slightly differently. I go back to the issue of coverage. Yeah. You need to have coverage to have access to 5G, end of the story. And we have been working on this to solve the problem. And as I said, it's commercialized. I think a few things. Applications or use cases. Fixed wireless access instead of fiber or to augment fiber. Indoor repeaters to bring the signal in instead of Wi-Fi or to augment Wi-Fi. And having mobile 5G in a mobile environment in an auto, which frankly nobody else has done, and I think it's a big deal. Now what happens as we speak about use cases? I think when you bring coverage, then you have endpoints that connect to the network. I think you need to have that done. Once you have the endpoint, you can run your applications in a B2B environment or a B2C environment. Once you have the applications, then we have these use cases that everybody talks about. Very hard to find, but now you're beginning to see them. And then, of course, use cases for us provide an experience. I think then the market takes off. Then we actually feel what this all means. And I think you have to bring it all together.
That's a great point. And Prasad?
Yeah, so I'll take the example of the cellular V2X because I think that's an interesting application. We have blessings from the 5G automotive associations in North America. So this is, again, a standards-defined capability in Release 14 in 2017. So there have been continuous enhancements in Release 15 and Release 16 and so on. So the CV2X is a pretty interesting application because it is redefining how the next generation of automotives are actually going to communicate, not only amongst each other, but also to the next generation of cloud services, right? It's not only vehicle to vehicle, but it is also vehicle to infrastructure, vehicle to roadside users, vehicle to like cloud services as an example. So, and it's going to redefine how the next generation of autonomous vehicles and all that are actually going to move. And the other important thing to remember here is that there are a lot of implications, as our colleagues have pointed out, in terms of the coverage, right? Because LTE has been laid out in the industry today. LTE is ubiquitous. We say that it's ubiquitous everywhere, and LTE is not going out anywhere soon. So which basically means that these cars have to actually have a means to actually have a coverage of not only 5G, but also on the LTE. And imagine scenarios wherein these cars are actually moving across the borders, right? Like we have Mexico to the south of the border, and we have Canada to the north of the border. And these vehicles, the next generation of vehicles, are actually going to move. So how are roaming services actually going to be established? What kind of roaming agreements are going to be in place for this new set of vehicles, right? Like with CV2X services and things like that. So I think that gives rise to a very good use case that the industry can actually look forward to. So how we can actually make it more commercial. So we have seen a presentation from Qualcomm today. Qualcomm has been doing a lot of work in driving the chipsets in the CV2X domain, all the way from release 14 to release 16 standards, and there's a lot of enhancements that are coming in release 17. How do we drive unicast and broadcast multimedia services for that particular features? I think there's a lot of opportunities for the next generation of automotives.
You touched on such an important point that I think is a challenge to all of us, is roaming.
Oh, yeah.
Right? I mean,
absolutely.
If you think about kind of standalone versus non-standalone, how do we deal with 4G to 5G roaming? But also, as we look at private networks, how are we going to roam from private networks onto macro networks? What are we going to do? Because if we don't, that's a hindrance to everything you just talked about.
Absolutely.
Right? Specifically for autos. CVX is such a good use case.
Yeah, and also the service continuity is actually going to be very critical.
Yeah.
So as you actually move shuttle across these different technologies, right, like the radio access technology, you move from 5G to 4G, or in some countries, like you might still have 3G, right?
Yep.
So, hey, what are you going to do, like, when you don't have a 4G or a 5G coverage? You have to fall back to 3G.
Yeah.
But we are fortunate that like the in North America at least, in the US I should say very explicitly, like we are 4G and 5G centric, and you have seen like the operators making announcements that they're actually shutting down 3G. Yeah. So at least like we have a blanket coverage of 4G, then you have 5G as an overlay on top of it. At least now you can shuttle across these technologies, but the key thing from a service provider's perspective is to be able to ensure that you give that service continuity and the end user experience. That is very critical.
Yeah, I think for all of us, you know, there's solutions out there, right? We can dual SIM, dual standby. We can try and convince someone to open up a signaling interface, but certainly the more elegant we make that, accelerates adoption. So if we look at kind of the permutations, Open RAN, we've talked a lot about Open RAN previously and now, is it ready for mainstream? Is power consumption because of disag gonna be too high? Is it really gonna lower TCO? Where do we think about Open RAN? And maybe Tahir, you can kick us off.
So how this market will evolve, I think there'll be different flavors and ultimately different service providers will hone in on a certain application or architecture that works for them. Our focus has been to make sure that the radio part, the access part, the coverage part is extremely efficient, low power, cost effective, because I think that's when the market takes off.
Yeah.
And that's when everything is made possible. So our view is enable the market and then enable the entire ecosystem.
Yeah. Excellent. Prasad, how about?
Yeah, so Radis is where we come from, like is a strong proponent of Open RAN. And we develop and license our protocol software stacks to more than 60 OEMs today. Like if you look at the big and traditional vendors, you have Radisys as a stack behind them. So Open RAN, it definitely I would say that if you really look at the North American landscape, obviously you haven't seen any announcements from the top tier one vendors because obviously like they have hundreds and thousands of cell sites and they're not going to just rip and replace the cell sites. But Open RAN can definitely find a place in private 5G type of a deployments, wherein it is like more or less like a greenfield type of deployment, whether it's like, let's say, a factory automation or like, for example, like a campus environment. I think Open RAN definitely has to prove that it can actually deliver its performance because we have started to disaggregate the RAN and we have a lot of different ways of actually spinning these different network functions. And this Open RAN has to work with the 5G core as an example, right? And you have to create that end-to-end ecosystem, and that ecosystem has to work and deliver the same or even better performance than a macro RAN, a traditional macro RAN. Then we can prove that, yeah, Open RAN is actually, it has reached its prime time and you can actually massively deploy that. Yeah. So tier ones would definitely look for that.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, is the ecosystem ready to support that, even in those surgical deployments as a proof point? So. Harvinder, take us home. Open RAN, what do you think?
Yeah, so I think Open RAN is a great initiative. There's a lot of good work happening. But just the fact that we are disaggregating on functional partition, we are disaggregating on control plane, user plane perspective, and we are also disaggregating on radio resource management in terms of RAN intelligent controllers. So there are multiple players coming into being to create a network, and also on top of that, we have system integrator, right? And then what we are seeing is just because of the fact that a lot of the specs are being written, some of the specs are going through major revision every 6 months. Say ORAN, control plane, user plane, is the sixth release that was released this year, and the seventh one is in the making. So that creates a lot of challenges for interoperability. So what I believe is that operators have to incubate ORAN ecosystem to begin with, and there will be always a gap between what ORAN ecosystem can deliver to begin with. But eventually they'll catch up, right? So there has to be some incubation, there has to be some facilitation, as what we have seen in some greenfield deployment, where operators have told the specs to the provider so that they can interoperate automatically, because the specs are being specified in a manner that they'll automatically interoperate versus having an older version of ORAN spec and having different variety of features supported there. So I think that is the key here. Operators have to incubate it. And eventually, they'll get the benefit of total cost of ownership, plus also open up their RAN for XApps, you know, which can really help them monetize and load balance and squeeze as much capacity as they can get from these networks.
Big round of applause for our panelists. Thank you guys so much. Please have a wonderful conference.